है ना, आता समजा तू ऑन केलंस तुझा व्हिडिओ आणि सरांनी तर आपण एक पिक्चर काढून टाकू.
राईट. ऍक्च्युली मॅडम माझा काय व्हिडिओ ना, हा येतो मध्येच मध्येच गायब होतोय,
हो
निकल
गुप्ता सर आपका व्हिडिओ
होतोय.
ऑन कीजिए ना, उपाध्याय सर आपका भी एक फोटो ले लेते हैं.
माझा ऍक्च्युली माहिती नाही व्हिडिओत काहीतरी प्रॉब्लेम होतोय,
अगं
मध्ये
ना
येतो
मगाशी
मध्ये नाही येत.
मगाशी, हां तुझं ऑन
हा
कर मी पटकन काढते एक मिनिट. अरे
नाही माझा
गेला
ऑनच आहे, माझा ऑनच आहे.
तू जाते आहे पण येऊन जाऊन येते आहे.
हा
तू
हा हा राईट राईट,
तुझं नाव
काहीतरी
येत नाही
प्रॉब्लेम आहे.
त्याच्यावरती, तुझं आर येत आहे, नाही तर मग नाव जरी आलं तरी चालतं.
मी
करता
बघते
येईल
आहे
का?
कुठे काय
बिलकुल
करता येईल त्याच. इट सीम्स काहीतरी सॉफ्टवेअर प्रॉब्लेम आहे तो.
एक मिनिट. मी पुन्हा चेक करते
हाँ
तोपर्यंत,
मैम काढून घ्या.
एक सेकंड मी ते पेस्ट करते, एक सेकंड. हा ओके ओके से. अरे उपाध्याय सर चले गए क्या? अरे रुजिता पण गेली. रुजिता
या आय एम हियर ओनली मॅम.
कसं करते, येतच
ठीक आहे ना, जसा आहे तसा काढून घेऊया.
नाही आहे, ब्लँक आहे तू. हा आला आला, लेट्स सी.
ओके
वन मोमेंट, एटलीस्ट फॉर रेकॉर्ड वी नीड वन पिक्चर ना.
या
यस आली आहे तू, पुन्हा गेली रे बाबा.
मॅम जाऊ द्यात, पण तसाच काढून
दॅट्स फाईन,
घेऊया.
तुझा ऑडिओ चांगला आहे, काही प्रॉब्लेम नाही. सो
ठीक
यू
आहे
आर द होस्ट आणि तू आता ना गुप्ता सर आणि उपाध्याय सरांना को होस्ट करून टाक. सो गो टू
ओके.
पार्टिसिपेंट्स, गो टू पार्टिसिपेंट्स आणि गुप्ता सरांच्या नावावर क्लिक केलं की ते मोर ऑप्शन दिसेल तुला.
एक सेकंड. हाँ
मोर वरती तुला खाली ड्रॅग केलं की मेक को होस्ट ऑप्शन नसेल,
राईट.
तसंच डॉक्टर उपाध्यायांना पण करून दे को होस्ट.
राईट
आता दुसरं ऑप्शन तुला सांगते, म्हणजे तू लेक्चर सुरू करायच्या आधी अनम्यूट सगळ्यांना करायसाठी खालचं म्यूट ऑलचं ऑप्शन दिसेल तुला पार्टिसिपेंट मध्ये सगळ्यात खाली,
हाँ
ते क्लिक कर, एक विंडो येईल.
म्यूट ऑल ना.
हा आता ते एकदम करू
हाँ
नको. ओके हा, त्याच्यानंतर खाली एक लाईन येते, अलाउ टू अनम्यूट देमसेल्स वाली एक लाईन येते, त्याच्या समोर एक विंडो आहे छोटीशी.
म्यूट ऑल मी ऑप्शन ऑन केला आहे.
एक आता तो एकदम क्लिक नको करू कारण आम्ही म्यूट होऊन जातो. आता ते अलाउ टू
ओके.
अनम्यूट आहे ना,
हाँ
त्याच्यावरती
हाँ
आता त्याच्यावरती टिक केलाय म्हणून आम्ही अनम्यूट करू शकतो. हा
ओके.
पण तू काय करशील, त्याला अनटिक करशील तर फक्त को होस्ट आणि होस्ट स्वतःला अनम्यूट.
मॅम मला असं वाटतं मी राहू देते जे आहे ते.
आता तुम्ही तिघ जण आहे, तू होस्ट आहेस आणि गुप्ता सर आणि उपाध्याय सर को होस्ट आहे,
हाँ
ठीक आहे. म्यूट
ओके.
ऑल वर गेल्यानंतर तू अजून क्लिक करू नकोस. म्यूट ऑल केल्यानंतर तो
हाँ
अल
हाँ
खाली एक लाईन येते त्या विंडो मध्ये, काय लिहिलंय बघ त्याच्यावर.
ते येत नाहीये मला.
तू म्यूट ऑल केल्यावर काय लिहून येत
म्यूट ऑल केल्यावर काही लिहून येत नाहीये. अलाउ पार्टिसिपंट्स टू
आहे ना,
अनम्यूट.
अलाव पार्टिसिपेंट्स आहे ना,
हाँ
त्याच्या समोर एक
हाँ
छोटासा
हाँ
बॉक्स आहे
नाही 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 असं काही नाहीये मॅम.
अलावच्या, तिथे क्लिक केलं की एक टिक होईल ना, टिक झालं म्हणजे तू अलाव करते आणि तू अनटिक केलं म्हणजे तू कोणाला अलाव नाही करत अनम्यूट करायला एक्सेप्ट होस्ट को होस्ट.
अलाउ पार्टिसिपेंट्स टू अनम्यूट देमसेल्व.
हा तिथे बघ एक टिक
हे
करायला बॉक्स आहे छोटासा, छोटीशी बॉक्स असताना टिक करतो आपण, क्लिक करतो
ओके. हा हा
तर त्याला जर तू क्लिक केलं की लोक अनम्यूट करू शकतात, पण तू त्याला टिक नाही केलंस तर फक्त तुम्ही तिघं अनम्यूट म्यूट करू शकता, बाकी सगळे म्युटेड
ओके
राहतात.
ओके ओके
गॉट इट?
ओके. ठीक आहे ना मॅम. ठीक आहे
ऑल राईट. मी आता एक तर पिक्चर
ठीक
घेतला,
आहे
आता मी लॉग आउट करते कारण माझी अजून एक मीटिंग आहे आता.
राईट. चालेल
आता
ना मॅम.
मेन्यू कमिटीची मीटिंग आहे ऑफिसला तर मला ती.
ओके ओके
ओके
ओके ओके
या ऑल द बेस्ट, यू विल रॉक.
या थँक यू सो
रेकॉर्ड
मच मॅम.
विसरू नकोस, रेकॉर्ड विसरू नकोस, बाकी
ओ हो
भक्ती
हो
खाय गे टेन्शन मध्ये, भक्ती विसरून गेली रेकॉर्ड करायला.
ठीक आहे.
ठीक आहे ओके देन
हो
करशील, मग झालं की फोन
पण
बोलू आपण.
तुम्हाला लिंक आली आहे का रेकॉर्डची, कारण मी ऑन केला आहे.
नाही आता बंद कर, आतापासून नको करू रेकॉर्ड. स्टॉप कर खाली तरी स्टॉप स्टॉप करून टाक.
Good evening, all of you. I am Dr. Rujuta Phuke and I work as Associate Professor in Government Medical College, Nagpur. For today's presentation, now let me just start the screen sharing. Just a second. So the topic of today's discussion is menstrual issues. It's basically a gynecological topic, menstrual issues from adolescence to menopause. And I will also try to cover cancer screening and vaccination. So should I start? Am I audible?
Yeah, madam. Yes, madam. You are audible. You can go ahead. Okay.
So coming to first the normal menstruation. Normal menstruation, we all know it is normally, it occurs every 21 to 35 days. Some cycles can be short, which starts from the, which occur every 21 days, or some can be long, like they occur every 35 days, but these are well within the normal limit. The average blood loss is 35 to 40 ml, and it lasts for usually 2 to 3 days. And it is accompanied by some amount of dysmenorrhea. So dysmenorrhea, when we call it as a primary dysmenorrhea, when it is associated with no organic or psychological cause. So usually all young teenage girls with the onset of menstruation, they all experience this primary dysmenorrhea, which lasts for a day or a two during menses. So what I have tried to cover, the normal menstruation as well as the menstrual problems like oligomenorrhea, amenorrhea, and menorrhagia, which occur in the different age group. And I have tried to summarize in clinical examination, investigations, and the treatment manner. So first of all, being dysmenorrhea being common, I'll start with dysmenorrhea. So for the simple dysmenorrhea, which every teenage girl experiences in the earlier age, the treatment is usually analgesics like NSAIDs, which reduce pain as well as blood flow, because these are mainly the prostaglandin synthetase inhibitors. And that is why the prostaglandin is the main hormone which is responsible for the dysmenorrhea. The another option is combined oral contraceptives, which prevent ovulation and thereby reduces the dysmenorrhea. Surgery is not required. And if the pain is not relieved, then we should think of some cause, underlying cause, which is responsible, and we should refer the patient. Secondary dysmenorrhea, however, is usually because of the organic or psychological cause. It is usually, the onset is in adult life, starts before menses and increases as the menstruation approaches. So it starts before 1 or 2 days before the menses. And the causes can be endometriosis, adenomyosis, uterine polyps, fibroids, PID, and psychosexual problems. That means all the organic pathologies in the pelvis are responsible for secondary dysmenorrhea. Now, coming to endometriosis, which is a main cause of secondary dysmenorrhea, it is the presence of endometrial tissue in the sites other than the uterus. 20% of the patients, they do not have any symptom. And those who have the symptom, they usually fall into 30 to 40 years of category. They are nulliparous, or they have low parity or subfertility. Usually characterized by heavy menstrual period, secondary dysmenorrhea, and deep dyspareunia, that is pain during sexual intercourse, and also pain between menses. Rectal bleeding, strictures, cyclical hematuria, these are common in case the endometriosis involves the rectum. Cyclical swelling and pain in abdominal wounds is also one of the presentation of endometriosis. On examination, there is tenderness and mass in the lower abdomen, and there can be abdominal wall deposits in case of endometriosis. there are tender nodules in the uterosacral ligaments, and there can be tender fixed retroverted uterus, and there can be nodules in the vagina. So these are in the severe varieties of endometriosis. Normally we do not get any finding, or if we do laparoscopy, which is a gold standard for diagnosis of endometriosis, we can see powder burn appearances, or there can be strictures, adhesions. Ultrasound is also another modality, but the best gold standard is a laparoscopy. Now, treatment of endometriosis, usually we do not want the patient to ovulate, or we do not want the patient to have menses. So the medical management is by combined oral contraceptives for 6 to 9 months. These pseudo-pregnancy-like states, combined oral contraceptives, they cause pseudo-pregnancy-like states, which helps in the regression of the endometriotic deposits. Alternatively, we can give injection Depo Provera for 6 to 9 months, and Danazol is one of the drug which is also active in endometriosis, but it is the use is less because it has androgenic side effects. The dose is usually 200 to 800 milligram per day, again for 6 to 9 months. Medroxyprogesterone acetate is another progesterone which can be given 30 milligram per day, and there are higher drugs like GnRH analogs. In case of severe endometriosis, we can definitely try these drugs, but maximum period is 6 months, above which we cannot give GnRH analogs because they lead to menopause-like state and may lead to long-term osteoporosis in females. If the patient is not relieved by these symptoms, we have to refer these patients to the higher centers. Surgical management of endometriosis can be because of the laparotomy or laparoscopy. Or radically, in severe cases, we can undergo total abdominal hysterectomy with bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy plus excision of the endometriotic lesions. Adenomyosis is similar to endometriosis, but here the deposits are in the myometrium. The females are usually older, nulliparous women. They have secondary dysmenorrhea or menorrhagia secondary to fibroids and DUP. Examination shows tender enlarged uterus, and usually treatment is surgical, that is hysterectomy. Uterine polyps is one of the cause of dysmenorrhea. The patient has pain in the mid-cycle and polyps can be seen through the cervix. Treatment is excision of the polyps. Chronic PID is because of the infections. Repeated acute attacks of infections can lead to chronic pain, and they may cause secondary dysmenorrhea. Usually the uterus is tender, adnexa are also tender, and fixed retroverted uterus is there. Laparoscopy can diagnose this condition. We can see adhesions in the pelvis. Treatment is prolonged antibiotic therapy for 3 to 6 months. And if this treatment fails, then we have to go for total abdominal hysterectomy with bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy. Psychosexual problems can also lead to secondary dysmenorrhea, which is common in the third and the fourth decade, over anxiety, emotional instability. Or it can be a part of premenstrual syndrome. Now, another common menstrual problem is menorrhagia, when we say that the cycles are too long or heavy, that is, lasts for more than eight days, and heavy means the period, that is, the amount of blood loss is more than 80 ml in a cycle. Polymenorrhagia is too frequent menstruation, less than 21 days. The frequency is every less than 21 days. Hypomenorrhea is too scanty menstruation. Oligomenorrhea is too infrequent. That is, a cycle occurs every 2 or 3 months. Amenorrhea means there is no menses. And intermenstrual bleeding and postcoital bleeding are another forms of the menstrual problems. Now, excessive menstrual loss is menstrual loss when it is more than 80 ml. Causes can be physiological, intrauterine devices, infections, neoplastics like the fibroids or C. endometrium, functional ovarian tumors and uterine polyps, blood dyscrasias and psychological factors. Now, physiological menstrual loss, excessive menstrual loss is seen in the early years of life and in the extremes of age group, like the early years, that is during menarche and perimenopausal because of the anovulatory cycles. Now, dysfunctional uterine bleeding is defined as the uterine bleeding which is because of no organic lesions. It can be ovulatory or anovulatory. There is some hormonal problem in the cycle, and either this bleeding is associated with regular ovulation or there is no ovulation, and that is why the patient is bleeding. Now, anovulation is common in extremes of life, as I told you. It is because of the CHO intolerance, that is the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis, is disturbed. It is usually older, obese, and endocrine disease. It is seen in the endocrine diseases like hypothyroidism. Prolonged periods of amenorrhea followed by heavy persistent bleeding is usually the picture seen in dysfunctional uterine bleeding. The average age is 35 to 45 years, and patient usually have abdominal discomfort, dysmenorrhea, dyspareunia. Cycle is usually regular but heavy in case of the dysfunctional uterine bleeding. The management is history, as we take in the diagnostic workup. On examination, patient has anemia, obesity, some endocrine disorders like thyroid or blood diabetes mellitus. Investigations includes blood profile, clotting screening, thyroid function tests, and glucose tolerance test if indicated. This condition can be diagnosed with ultrasound where you do not see any organic pathology. That is, it's the diagnosis of exclusion. And we have to actually take endometrial biopsy in all cases on all females who are more than 40 years of age. Medical treatment is the mainstay of treatment for these anovulatory cycles. In case of adolescents and young, we usually prefer to give them combined oral contraceptives or cyclical progesterone. And in perimenopausal female, we give cyclical progesterone, or if she is having menopause-like symptoms, then we give her hormone replacement treatment, which usually contains progesterone. Now, if the patient is bleeding heavily and there is acute onset of heavy bleeding, it has to be controlled by high dose of progesterone. And the progesterone has to be tapered slowly. For example, if we prefer norethisterone, which is a component of primolute N, which is prescribed very commonly, we have to start with 30 milligram BD for 3 days, followed by 20, followed by 10, followed by 5 milligram BD for 10 days. So total duration of treatment is 19 days. Then we stop progesterone, which is followed by withdrawal bleeding. So this is the mainstay of treatment. The medical management is the mainstay of treatment. In case of ovulatory cycles where there is regular ovulation, the mainstay of treatment is the antifibrinolytic therapy, that is tranexamic acid, Tranexa, which we usually prescribed 1 to 3 grams per day. Prostaglandin synthetase inhibitors can also be given. Combined oral contraceptives after excluding contraindications, because we have to look for contraindications of combined oral contraceptives, like if the patient has liver dysfunction or if she has severe diabetes mellitus or she has uncontrolled hypertension, then these are all the contraindications for starting combined oral contraceptives. Danazol can be given, but as I already said, it is androgenic, so we do not usually prefer this drug. Surgical treatment, of course, we have the option of hysterectomy, but we have to consider her age and her willingness for any permanent management or permanent surgical management. Endometrial ablation is one treatment which is also available, in which we just ablate the endometrium so that the cause, the source of the bleeding is directly taken care of, but we have to be absolutely sure that there is no CA endometrium or endometrial carcinoma to the patient. That can be diagnosed with endometrial biopsy. Fibroid is one of the neoplasms, which is common, very, very common, commonest tumor of female genital tract. Usual occurrence is 35 to 45 years. In nulliparity, infertility, it can be symptom lapse. It can cause menorrhagia, intermenstrual bleeding if it is associated with polyp, and it can cause lump in abdomen. Now, on examination, you can see lump in abdomen arising from the uterus. Usually, investigation is by ultrasonography and MRI. And the line of management is same as that of the DUP. We give all kinds of drugs to start with NSAIDs, NSAIDs, followed by tranexamic acid, followed by combined oral contraceptives, and followed by combined oral contraceptives, and then followed by progesterone therapy. So stepwise, we have to escalate the different drugs. And finally, myomectomy or hysterectomy is the last resort of managing the fibroids. When the patient has intermenstrual bleeding, usually it is the mid-cycle bleeding. Slight bleeding is common at the time of ovulation, which is just needs reassurance to the young females. Premenstrual, if it is intermenstrual bleeding, then it is because of the defective corpus luteum. That means there is deficiency of progesterone. The corpus luteum is not producing progesterone, and we have to supplement the progesterone. Then there are different types of progesterones that is available, synthetic and natural. So natural progesterones is usually the microgests or natural gest tablets which we give, and the synthetic are the metroxyprogesterone, acetate and norethisterone. Neoplasms can cause intermenstrual bleeding, so we have to see for endometrial or cervical polyps. Some infective pathologies, cervicitis or infected polyps, also can lead to intermenstrual bleeding. Now, postcoital bleeding is usually because of the local causes. Local causes of the cervix and vagina, like cervicitis, ectropion, atrophic vaginitis, etc. But out of which, the most important is CA cervix, which we have to rule out in every patient by doing the perspicular examination. And again, treatment depends on the cause which is responsible for postcoital bleeding. Now, amenorrhea is the absence of menses, which is also one of the common complaints which we see in our clinical practice. So if the patient has no menses up to 14 years of age and there are no secondary sexual characteristics, then we can say that the patient has primary amenorrhea. Or if the patient is 16 years of age and she has secondary sexual characters, but still she is not menstruating, then again this leads for us to look for the causes of amenorrhea. So the primary amenorrhea, the problems can be developmental, like we have absent uterus. This is known as MRKH syndrome. The uterus is congenitally absent, or there can be imperforate hymen. The hymen is imperforate, there she is menstruating, but that menstrual blood is not coming out and it is actually collecting inside and causing the hematometra and pyometra. There can be vaginal atresia, there can be transverse vaginal septum. These are all the surgical treatment, these are all the surgical conditions, which congenital conditions and which can be managed surgically. Chromosomal abnormalities like in Turner's syndrome, there can be amenorrhea, primary amenorrhea. Now in some females, because of the anorexia nervosa, it's a psychological condition. Patient refuses to eat, she's very thin built. This is all the hypothalamic causes of amenorrhea. So treatment is usually according to the cause, and we have to refer this patient. Has had menses for few months and then she stopped having menses. Physiologically, secondary amenorrhea could be in the puberty, adolescence. It can be in the lactation, pregnancy, and after menopause. Pathologically, the most common is the stress-related amenorrhea. There can be the most common condition of the ovaries is the polycystic ovarian syndrome, which is quite common in young females. And we have to look for this polycystic ovarian syndromes in this evaluation of the every case of secondary amenorrhea. It can be hyperprolactinemia, hypo or hyperthyroidism, and premature menopause. Now these are in short all the conditions of the menstrual problems which we come across in our clinical practice. Now something about the cancer prevention and cancer. Shall I continue this? Most important cancer that I'm going to speak about is the cancer cervix, which is the second most common cancer in India, next only to the breast cancer. But till now, it was the most common cancer. Now, what, who, when, and how? And can you do something to prevent it? So these are a few of the questions we'll try to answer here. It is the most common cancer. And if we see statistically, every year we get 122,844 cases and 67,000 deaths because of the cervical cancer. Now we all know whatever we have been told earlier about the high risk behavior and everything. Usually now HPV 16 and 18 virus, human papilloma virus 16 and 18 is responsible for more than 90% of the cases of cervical cancer. And the incidence is highest amongst 40 to 64 years of the women. Now this is all to show you the burden of diseases in India. Now what causes the cervical cancer? Causative factor is the virus, HPV virus, but these are all the high risk factors which lead to the either the infection because of the HPV virus or the HPV infection stays in the body because of these conditions like the multiple sexual partners, having more number of children, early marriage, family history, smoking, oral contraceptive pills, unprotected sex, and early childbirth. Now, what happens? This, when the cervical cells are infected with HPV 16 and 18, it leads to some changes in the cervical cells. And these are the cells, changes which we see here. And this is a process. It goes, undergoes through the changes which occur for over 10 or 15 years. So that is the window, that is a period we get where we can screen these women to know the pre-invasive stage of the cancer. And this is known as the prevention, primary prevention, early detection and prevention of the cancer. Now, what are the warning signs of cervical cancer? Unusual vaginal discharge, which may be foul smelling, abnormal vaginal bleeding, prolonged and heavy periods, urinary discomfort, pain during intercourse, fatigue, dizziness, leg pain, backache, abdominal pain, weight loss, leg swelling, bleeding or spotting after menopause, and blood in the stools. These are the various presentations of the cervical cancer. Now, clinically, if you do paraspeculum examination, you can see exophytic growth, endophytic growth, and ulcerative. There are the three types of lesions which are present clinically. But most common is the exophytic growth. You see cauliflower-like growth on the cervix, which is very diagnostic of cervical cancer. Now, confirmation is by pelvic examination, systemic examination, pap smear, colposcopy, cervical biopsy. These are the staging of the cervical cancer. The last is the stage 4, where it invades the bladder, rectum, and metastasis. And usually we get the patients when the cancer has advanced to the stage 4. So our aim is to get the patients when to pick up the patients and to pick up the disease in the earlier stages, that is stage either 0 or 1 or maybe even the precancerous stages. Now, how do we do this prevention? We all know we have a very good test known as the pap smear test, where we can actually counsel and educate women to undergo pap smear at least once in her lifetime to detect the cancer. Now, this prevention is important, and particularly it is very interesting in case of carcinoma cervix, because that carcinoma cervix undergoes through a very long pre-invasive state. We have very good quality, good cytological screening programs. We have treatments which is available for pre-invasive lesions, and the cervix is easily accessible to the direct examinations. And these cervical cells, they exfoliate. So we can collect these cells and subject them to examination. Now, what kind of we'll come to this later on. Different investigations or different screening procedures that we can do for cervical screening is the visual inspection by acetic acid. We apply acetic acid on the cervix and we see for the acetovite lesions. Now, here you can see few acetovite lesions. These are the acetovite lesions which are pathological. If you see such acetovite lesions after application of the acetic acid, that means she is harboring some kind of neoplasia or precancerous lesions or CIN lesions, and she needs further workup. Now, another test is the VILI, that is visual inspection by Lugol's iodine. We apply Lugol's iodine to the cervix and look for the areas. Now, normally the areas are Lugol's iodine stains these dark brown, but if you see yellow patches, then these are again pathological, which needs further workup. Another method we all know is the pap smear. Pap smear is collected with a cyto brush, sprayed on the slide, and it is examined. So prerequisites before taking pap smear that the patient should not be menstruating, should not have sexual intercourse a day prior, there should be no vaginal douching, no application of antiseptic and antibiotics, and we have to take pap smear before doing pelvic examination. So these are the factors which actually, if we follow these rules, there are more chances of getting a good pap smear here. Now, how frequently? The SCOG recommends that it should commence at the age of 21, and it should be repeated every 2 years from 21 to 29 years, and every 3 years from 30 years. But in India, which is said that at least once in her lifetime, a female should undergo pap smear examination. Now, liquid-based cytology is another advanced to the pap smear. We take the exfoliated cervical cells by cytobrush and we transport it in a medium so that we actually get a good yield of the cells. HPV DNA, we can confirm if at all some finding, we get some positive finding, we can confirm by HPV DNA. And HPV DNA, if that is positive, then we have to refer the patient or we have to treat the patient according to whatever is the pathology. Colposcopy is another gold standard for the diagnosis of all CIN lesions. Now, how do we prevent? Okay. Prevention, do we have some vaccine for this HPV prevention? Yes, definitely. We have HPV vaccine, which are Gardasil, Gardasil 9, and Cervarix, which is given to all females from 11 to 49 years. It is said up, it is 49, at least it should be given from 15 to 45 years of age group. It provides immunity by antibiotics and the dose is 0.5 ml intramuscularly. We give three doses at 0, 2 and 6 months. It may lead to some allergic reactions like dizziness, fainting and soreness. But it does not prevent or treat new infections. So we have to keep on doing the cervical screening for these patients. The effect lasts for up to 10 years and it is yet not recommended for pregnant women. And it is also recommended for women who already have or treated HPV infection, and vaccinated women still needs to be screened by pap smear. Now, coming to the treatment part of the pre-cervical lesions. Pre-cervical lesions, either we can ablate or we can remove. There are two types of treatment, excisional and ablational. Ablational, we have this different types of lasers, laser treatments, or we have this thermo or electro ablation. These are the different instruments by which we can actually treat. And excision is LEAP by LEAP. That is the loop electro excisional procedure of the cervix, where we take out a part of the cervix, we take out a loop-shaped area of the cervix, that is transformation zone. We remove the transformation zone, which is the main site of cervical cancer, origin of the cervical cancer. So these are all the treatment modalities of the precancerous lesion of the cervix. Now, 6 ways to prevent cervical cancer. We have to get a regular pap smear, limit the amount of sexual partners you have, quit smoking, avoid secondhand smoke. If you are sexually active, use condom, barrier method, follow up abnormal pap smears and get HPV vaccine. So how to keep yours? These are the different ways to take the, to keep the cervix healthy. HPV vaccine, 3 shots over 6 months and recommended for age 11 to 12. Most effective before sexual activity begins. Get the pap smear done at 21 years and every 3 years. And this is what we have to educate the to the female, each female which is coming to our OPD. This is must. We must educate them and we must teach them the importance of cervical screening as well as self-breast examination for breast cancer screening. And we must educate them about the warning signs that are suggestive of the cancers. So I think this is all. I hope I touched the different menstrual problems as well as the, in short, the cervical cancer, which I think is most important for in our setup as well as the preventing modalities to prevent the cancers. Okay.
Thank you, Rutuja, madam. I request all to unmute and you can stop, you can start your videos for any discussions, any questions. Dr. Ambedkar is here. It has been very informative talk, Dr. Rituja.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Unfortunately, I am not able to start my video. there is some problem in the video.
Your presentation but, was good.
It was really good interacting. I mean, yeah. I don't think I am able to start it. Okay. Right.
Achha, in all these conditions, as you said, that other
yes.
thing. Should we, as a family physician, take care that the patient is diabetic or hypertensive, suffering from blood pressure or diabetes? All these things may affect the menstruation and problem associated with it.
Right. The primary responsibility is to look for the underlying cause. We have just not seeing the patient for which she is coming. We are seeing the patient for the complete like general examination. We have to see her for the complaints because see, everything is interlinked. So we have to look for all the causes. And as a general physician and as a this is our responsibility that we look into all the things that are. The underlying that are the underlying problems she has.
Dr. Abhijit, you would like to ask question. Dr. Abhijit is very senior practitioner.
Right. Hello, sir. Hello, Abhijit sir. I think I am not able to hear. Let me unmute. Let me unmute.
Abhijit, yes.
Just a second.
Yes, Abhijit, you can speak now.
Yeah. I mean...
Hello?
Yes. Yeah, I hope you can hear me now.
Yes, sir. Definitely.
Hello?
Yes, sir. I can hear you, sir.
We are listening. No.
Sir, you can unmute. You are not audible. You can unmute. Please unmute, sir.
Your video is on, but the mic is still off. You have to unmute yourself.
Abhijit, sir, you have to unmute.
By going on participants.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hello.
Now, sir.
Now you can hear me?
Yes, sir. Definitely.
Okay. That's great. No, I just want to congratulate you, Rutuja ma'am, for giving a really informative talk. Actually, we really, being family physicians, we really have to face all these problems that you spoke about. Many times women come to us being family physicians, they ask certain questions. Sir. And sometimes are not able to, give a proper explanation to their problems. And nowadays, because the consultant are available, gynecologists, but so we can, of course, send them to the gynecologist directly. But still, it is really good to have this information. And at present, I don't have any questions. Congratulations for a very nice talk.
Yeah, that is what I want to say. What I want to say is, as a specialist, they only look for certain things when a patient walks in. But as a practitioner, you see the patient as a whole. So basically, that is what is important. There are less chances of missing out something. With this approach, there are less chances that you'll miss out something because you are seeing the patient as a whole.
Right.
Dr. Jhari has just joined. Sir, you have anything to comment? You want to speak something?
Unka bhi mute unmute ka problem ho sakta hai, Vijay sir. Wo thoda dekh lijiye.
Okay. So we end here. I thank you, Rituja Madam, and NOGS, and Dr. Vaidhi Marathe, Dr. Sen Gupta, for this nice informative meeting. And we have one more session left. I think it will be on next Saturday.
Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for the opportunity given to me, and it was very nice interacting with you.
Thanks.
Thank you so much.